The debate over the best way to teach reading has intensified in recent years as increasing numbers of academics and educators have backed structured literacy as opposed to the whole language learning method, which has been used in Kiwi schools for decades. In the so-called reading wars, this election, National has put a stake in the ground.
Let me be the judge.
Let's have a look. My vision for education in New Zealand is that we deliver consistent access to the very best possible teaching and resources to every single student, no matter where they are. And that starts with every single child learning to read using structured literacy. We will no longer be leaving literacy to chance in New Zealand.
Erica Stanford announced $60 million in funding to teach kids using structured literacy.
Every school will have the choice of a structured literacy provider to give all teachers the knowledge of the science of reading, the understanding of how the brain learns to read, and the structured literacy approach.
Out of this hole.
As part of its policy, National would end funding for the Reading Recovery Program, versions of which have been used in Kiwi schools for decades.
I can read to my teacher.
And backing structured literacy gets in ahead of recommendations from the Ministry of Education, which is still working on its advice for how to best teach literacy.
This really undermines the work that they have done and are doing, and I'm very, very shocked that it's a taking with one hand and giving with the other with the getting rid of reading recovery and early literacy supports.
But under National, in what would be an unusual step in our education system, structured literacy would be mandated in Kiwi schools. The response to National's policy has been mixed. The Lifting Literacy Aotearoa advocacy group says it's a great decision, while teacher unions have expressed concern at mandating over teaching styles. But one of those who will be watching this space closely is American education journalist Emily Hanford. She spent years reporting on the so-called reading wars and recently visited for the inaugural New Zealand Literacy Symposium.
Learning to speak, unless you have a hearing problem or a severe cognitive deficit, a child will learn to speak her native language. All she needs to do is be spoken to. And of course, that happens over many years, right? There's five or six years before kids go to school where they're hearing their native language and learning to speak it. And learning to read is foundationally based in that you bring to the table your knowledge of spoken language, your language comprehension. You have an advantage. The more you know about spoken language, the more vocabulary you have. That is a huge assist in learning how to read, but it's not enough. You have to learn that there is this relationship between the words you know how to say and know the meaning of, and this code, the way that they're written on the page. And the most efficient and effective way to make sure that all kids have the opportunity to be good readers is to start right at the beginning of their schooling, showing them this is how it works. This is how the sounds and the words that you know how to say are represented by the letters and words. Let's learn about those sounds. Let's learn about those letters. Let's learn how to blend those words together. And too many kids in the United States and in New Zealand and in other parts of the world aren't getting off to a good start with reading, and they're ending up behind early, and the kids who get off to a good start go sort of like get better and better and better. It's called the Matthew effect, essentially. It's like the rich get richer when it comes to reading. And some kids are really stuck and are sort of compromised readers for a lot of their lives because they weren't taught how to read. And in some cases were actually taught how to read like struggling readers.
What you're describing is the difference between structured literacy, which is predominantly phonics-based instruction, and balanced literacy or whole language instruction, which tells a child to consider a range of different things. So to perhaps look at pictures or to think of the context around a missing word. And why is the debate between these two different teaching styles so contentious?
It's fascinating. In the United States, there have been arguments about this going back to the beginning of public education. And I think one of the reasons there's a lot of emotion in this debate is I think these different sort of sides got associated with other kinds of beliefs, political views, like in the United States anyway, sort of the idea of teaching phonics and explicitly starting with the code is sort of associated with a more traditional or conservative or even now sort of Republican kind of approach. And the sort of more whole language, which became balanced literacy, was more of a sort of progressive kind of approach, an approach where kids are discovering things on their own. And I think because it's been associated for so long with political beliefs, it made it difficult for a lot of people to really look at what the research was really saying about the fact that being taught the relationships between letters and sounds is a critical part of becoming a good reader.
At the launch of the government's literacy and numeracy strategy last year, the now Prime Minister said this: "Can I just add, the debate about whole language learning versus phonics, it's really just a combination of those things. The idea that you have to pick one or the other is really just a red herring." What do you think of that?
I think that that sounds like a good idea, but I think what I have figured out in my work as a reporter is that is a big part of the problem. What we do in the United States anyway, and I understand you've done it here, and that quote seems to tell me that that this is the case, is sort of add things on, right? Like, oh, we've learned some new things about how kids learn to read, so we'll add that in. And so the problem with sort of adding phonics into a whole language approach is that they're really based on different conceptions about how you become a reader. One is based on the idea that you really need to learn that relationship between letters and sounds, and that it really is most effective if you're explicitly taught that. The other is based more on this theory that, well, you don't have to sound out the words. You can, but you don't have to, because you can teach kids all these other strategies to figure out the words. You can teach them to think about what makes sense. Use the context, use the pictures, use the first letter, use the last letter. Earlier, I was saying that lots of kids are taught the habits of struggling readers. Those turn out to be the habits of struggling readers.
A particular focus for you is the efficacy of the Reading Recovery Program, a program that was developed here in New Zealand using the work of New Zealander Murray Clay and exported to countries around the world. How influential has Reading Recovery been?
I think it's been very, very influential. And I will say that I think that Murray Clay did some really, really essential things in understanding some of what struggling readers need. She identified that kids do need to be identified early and they need to be given help, and that many kids need very intense remediation and intervention early on, that there are some kids who are really struggling. So the Reading Recovery Program, she came up with that before there was really a good understanding about how people learn to read. And much of what is in the Reading Recovery Program is based on that sort of theory or idea about reading that turned out subsequently to not be right. So Murray Clay came up with her ideas in the 1960s. A lot of this research I'm talking about really started in the late 60s, 70s, 80s. By the 90s, it was really clear that much of the theory that Murray Clay and others, other whole language and balanced literacy advocates and theorists and professors in the United States and around the world based their work on, that it wasn't right.
Reading Recovery is still widely used today here in New Zealand as well as overseas. The program has recently gone through a refresh and includes phonics in a way that's much greater than previous iterations. Is that sufficient in your opinion?
Well, I think that is part of this sort of and plus and approach, which I think just is problematic because it's really important to recognize the other elements of the program that may not be as efficient as possible. Like, we are talking about time and money and lots of kids who really need help, and I think it's really critical to like in the United States, I think places that have just added phonics in but kept teaching kids those other strategies. Oh, well, you can sound out the words. Here's some phonics to help you sound out the words. But you can also do other things like look at the first letter, think of a word that makes sense, look at the picture. What I see in the United States, and I can't speak for New Zealand, is that those two things have been taught together, and that is one of the things I identified as a big part of the problem, because kids are getting sort of a mixed message.
Should the government mandate a teaching pedagogy in New Zealand schools, say, this is the way that all teachers should be teaching kids to read?
I think the government has a responsibility to make sure that teachers and schools understand how kids learn to read and that the way they're teaching is based on that research and knowledge. How you do that is sort of beyond me in terms of being an American and being a journalist, but I think that is really, really critical. What is a government for if we are not making sure, or a government that is involved in public education if we are not making sure that our youngest children know how to read? It is such a critical skill, and I think that's why I've stayed on this topic for as many years as I have. A lot of my reporting was about higher education and access to who gets access to college degrees, and then I started realizing, like, oh, this is so critical. It is the basis upon which all academic learning gets built, your ability to read. I mean, really, it's sort of, if you know how to read, you can kind of teach yourself anything, right?
Last question. Do you think we are at the beginning of the end of the debate?
I hope so. But one of the things about education that, at least in the United States, is we tend to change our mind about things a lot, right? And try things and then say really quickly, oh, that didn't work, we'll try something else. So I'm really hoping that we're on the long haul here, that there won't be a quick pivot away. And I'm hopeful about that because I think there are a huge number of people for whom this is really, really critical. And I don't think they will let schools turn away from this topic. I think there are many parents in the United States who say to me, it's too late for my children, but it's not too late for my grandchildren.